Hi everyone, Kristi here, and we're continuing on with my doctoral thesis investigating sex and gender as sources of heterogeneity in political attitudes and behaviors. In chapter two, to bring you up, remind you to where we are, we've gone through the introduction, which gave a sort of overview of a preview to some of the themes that are going to come up, and also gave an overview of the structure of the thesis. Chapter one, as you can see, was focusing on the gender gap. Sorry, just a moment while I clear my throat. Analyzing the gender gap, looking at American theories to account for the American gender gap and British theories to account for the British gender gap. In chapter two, we looked at ways that psychologists have evolved in terms of their understanding of what gender is and that it's not a bipolar spectrum. A dichotomous idea of man and woman with gender norms bound up with each side, but rather there's a range of characteristics that men and women share, but men tend to score higher on in terms of measures, and women tend to score higher on other certain kinds of measures. And now to bring some of these ideas together, we're going to be looking at Chapter 3, which is the chapter where I explain the setup and the procedures that I used for developing the internet survey that resulted in the number of about 2,890 cases from respondents that I used in the statistical analysis. So we're going to start there. So let's go. Chapter 3, The Internet Survey and Gender Measures. In order to conduct the necessary empirical analysis to determine whether sex and gender are separate concepts, with each contributing a separate amount of explanation to people's political attitudes and preferences, a large number of survey respondents were needed. A multifaceted research funding proposal to study gender as a source of political preference heterogeneity, with an aim of testing possible drivers of gender and sex differences, was accepted by the Economic and Social Research Council in 2006. In order to properly study the relationships, if any, between sex, gender, and political attitudes and behaviors, a sufficient number of participants for subgroup analysis where previous British gender differences had been found would be necessary. As mentioned in Chapter 1, Pippa Norris outlined the gender generation gap in Britain. She showed younger women were more likely to vote for Labour than younger men, and that older women were more likely to vote Conservative than older men. In addition, the work of Rosie Campbell also suggested the importance for British men and women's political preferences of subgroup populations related to or determined by age, cohort, income, and parenthood. To understand wider societal patterns, a minimum number of men and women across all age groups were needed. This requirement was the main impetus for the decision to use an internet panel for the study. Although face-to-face interviews based on a random sampling selection would have been preferable, the funds needed to achieve our target of 3,000 cases for the main study was far beyond the funding available. Thus, for reasons of cost, sample size, rapid field deployment, and data turnaround time, an internet survey was used as the basis for this exploratory research. Internet surveys are increasingly being used in both business and in academic research, but the full implications of using non-probability internet panel data as compared to more established survey methods are not yet fully known. Malhotra and Krosnick used American data from the 2000 and 2004 American National Election Study to compare the accuracy of their findings in describing populations. Their American data produced results in which the face-to-face samples were more accurate than volunteer internet respondents. Bandia, Bosnick, and Altdorf administered one mode of the International Social Survey Program as a paper and pencil questionnaire and one as a web-based survey. The paper version was given to a representative sample of the German population and the online version to a panel representative for German internet users. After weighting the internet data based on socio-demographic variables, there were inconsistent findings for the two data sets. However, when a subsample of parallel respondents was compared, their study compared respondents with similar education levels, quote, "the results demonstrated a surprisingly high level of agreement across both methods. In other words, at least as far as the opinions of the highly educated public are concerned, the ISSP survey could have been conducted using a randomly recruited online panel by means of a web survey, unquote. Sanders et al. Analyzed British data based upon identically worded questionnaires from both the internet and face-to-face samples of the British election study. Their analysis showed, quote, few statistically significant differences between the coefficients generated using the in-person and internet data, unquote. In addition to their cost-effectiveness, internet surveys have the advantage of greater flexibility in question wording and format, access to verbatim past responses, thus reducing memory bias, and the self-administered format, removing the need for an interviewer, which may reduce social desirability bias. Other reasons to employ an internet survey included the flexibility in question wording, in question ordering, in response wording, and response ordering, which an online survey can easily provide. Therefore, the flexibility an internet study allows was an important consideration in the decision. Further, as this work was exploratory, the main concern was to analyze a large number of comparable men and women, rather than making generalizations from a probability sample to the wider population. As will be seen below, the substantially reduced costs associated with an internet study and the rapid turnaround time between fieldwork and data analysis allowed us to test and refine our questions in ways which would have been cost prohibitive in any other format. Finally, the author acknowledges that this research is exploratory, and any findings using internet data should in future be replicated using a face-to-face probability sample to test for any mode effects in order to make generalizable statements about the role of agency and communion outlooks in political attitudes and behaviors. In order to successfully investigate our areas of interest, Dr. Campbell and I decided that the development and deployment of a three-stage internet survey was most appropriate for our project. The first wave consisted of a test wave using newly created questions, existing questions imported from other existing surveys but not used in a British political science context, for example, the PAQ gender measures, and well-established political science questions which we could analyze with the newer measures. The second stage of the survey was a pilot survey in order to have a dry run of the measures that were chosen from the testing wave, as well as to conduct some comparisons of question wording and response options. Our final stage was the full survey, with a goal of 3,000 respondents. The structure and questions used in the main survey were informed by those results, analyses that were conducted on the trial measures in their initial testing and pilot waves. The next section reports on the results of the survey construction and selection of measures for the gender scales used in the rest of this investigation. Designing the survey. A challenge for this project, and for most of those that want to include multiple item scales into a survey, arose when deciding how to balance the need for a sufficient number of gender measures to obtain valid results with the restriction on how many questions overall respondents would be willing to answer and could answer accurately while making sufficient cognitive effort. The questions in the personal attributes questionnaire were not designed for large-end surveys covering several different topics. Whereas many surveys have between 3 and 5 questions to establish a scale, even the reduced PAQ developed by Ward et al. Had 18 questions. For internet respondents, who were paid a nominal sum for participating, 18 questions on gender alone were simply too many for a survey that was restricted to an overall number of questions between 80 and 90. It was decided that 3 measures for each concept, masculinity, femininity, and the MF scale, totaling 9 questions overall, was a reasonable balance between sufficient numbers of gender measures to create the scales for our planned data analysis. 9 questions represented 10% of the total number of questions asked in the survey. This allowed for a sufficient number of questions allotted to other topics that were important to our investigation and traditional measures we needed to include in order to replicate certain statistical models. As has been mentioned above, a special project on measurement validity had been included in the overall heterogeneity study. In my research and preparation for this study, I noted the importance of testing questions, which the authors below term pre-testing, as well as a paucity of documentation and publications as to how the questions were tested, what the results of the initial tests were, how the questions were modified as a result, and the final results. As Converse and Presser wrote, quote, pre-testing survey questionnaire is always recommended. No text and survey methods would speak against such hallowed scientific advice, but in practice it is probably often honored in the breach or the hurry. There is never the money, nor as deadlines loom, the time to do enough of it. There is a corollary weakness that the practice is intuitive and informal. There are not general principles of good pretesting, no systematization of practice, no consensus about expectations, and we rarely leave records for each other. How a pretest was conducted, what the investigators learned from it, how they redesigned their questionnaire on the basis of it, all these matters are reported only sketchily in research reports, if at all. Not surprisingly, the power of pretests is sometimes exaggerated, and their potential often unrealized. Although the main focus of this thesis is the application of gender measures to a political science survey and the explanatory power of sex and gender, it is also my hope that this chapter in particular will contribute to the underreported process of testing new survey measures. Several newly constructed and newly imported questions were tested in our internet survey, some with more success than others, but as the focus of this thesis are the measures of sex and gender, this section focuses upon the testing methods used to evaluate the accuracy and refinement of the available psychological measures and how the measures were selected. The process of survey development proceeded in the following fashion. The original proposal was based on focus group research conducted by Dr. Campbell and myself, the findings of which suggested men and women use different conceptual frameworks when discussing and evaluating politics. Part of our investigation was an attempt to better operationalize the gendered morality framework employed to measure the sociological account of the gender gap analysis, the ethics of justice and the ethics of compassion framework developed by Gilligan, into survey questions which could be used in statistical analysis. These concepts, imported from qualitative formats and transformed into quantitative ones, posed the largest challenge in the survey. Our concern about devising accurate measures for the gendered morality questions led us to create the three-stage survey plan outlined above. The first stage consisted of all the questions that were brand new, such as our morality questions, or had not been tested in a political science survey, such as the measures of gender and the personal attributes questionnaire. The aim was to administer the pretest survey to a sample large enough to achieve an N of around 300 respondents. This would allow us a sufficient number of participants to look for differences, but was a small enough wave to allow us to save sufficient funds for the large Ns we would need for the two survey waves still to come. After analyzing the pretest results and choosing the best measures, a second survey, the pilot survey, was administered. The pilot survey included a few experimental tests of question ordering and wording, as well as the measures that had been refined or altered based on the results of the pretest. In order to have sufficient respondents to evaluate the experiments, we set a goal of 1,000 participants for the pilot survey. Finally, after conducting the analysis on our refined measures and informed by the results of our pilot survey experiments, we set a goal of 3,000 participants for the final version of the survey. The data set from this main survey wave forms the basis of this thesis. The complete version of the questions we asked in each wave of the survey can be found in the appendices. All right, getting on 14 minutes. I think I might stop here because the next section is pretty chunky and clunky and it has a lot of numbers in it. And it might be better to kind of go to it when you're fresh and ready for it. So when we return, we will be looking at the testing and selecting of the measures from the PAQ, informed by the work of previous work that was done by Ward et al. And how that influenced the selection of measures in my dataset. Thank you guys for watching, or listening. You're watching less and probably listening more. I've been Kristi. You've been awesome. Thanks for your time and attention. Bye.